Hello everyone. So in this next lecture, we're going to focus on a topic called operations strategy. So when you think about this and you heard the word operations, now we in the first chapter, we talked about operations management. So the whole process of how we manage operations, how we commandeer the resources, how we plan the activities that needs to be done, how we allocate staff to the various activities, and how we get the products or services created. But here now we're saying that we want to focus on a topic called operations strategy. We suggest that operations has a strategic role to play. So in this chapter, we'll examine what we mean by operations strategy. Some of the learning objectives include the following: defining a mission and a strategy, because those two things or these two elements are very important for operations and they have implications for that operation strategy that we're about to talk about. Identify and explain three strategic approaches to achieving performance advantage. Now we can say competitive advantage, but I want to generalize it and call it performance advantage, because not-for-profits, if they're not competing, we want to talk about performance. And it is really on the basis of your performance that you compete. So we could sort of go a step back and say we're looking for performance advantage that will then strengthen your competitiveness if you are a competing organization, or simply strengthen your ability to achieve your mission and your vision. We want to identify and define the 10 decision areas of OM and how those 10 decision areas impact strategy and mission vision. Okay? And then understand the significance of key success factors and core competencies. What do we mean by key success factors? A key success factor is really a condition that must exist within an organization that allows it to succeed. Without that key success factor, it is very difficult for the organization to succeed. So if we're talking about competent employees as a key success factor, without competent employees, it is difficult to run a successful organization. And then when we talk about core competencies, that is the capabilities that the organization must have that are core to its mission and its vision. So those two aspects have some implications for operations. We're also going to identify and explain four global operations strategy options. So when companies decide that they want to go global, what does that mean for the operation strategy of the firm? Okay, so let's start off with the very first item, a definition. What do we understand by a mission and a vision and strategy? Excuse me. So all organizations, implicitly or explicitly, have some mission. They have a mission. They have a reason for existing. So why does Red Cross exist? Why does St. Mary's University exist? Why does Taco Bell exist? Why does Médecins Sans Frontières exist? Why does Cirque du Soleil exist? They all have a purpose. A mission, essentially, is a purpose, a reason for existing. So mission statements tell an organization what it's all about and where it wants to go. Also what it wants to achieve in terms of creating a legacy. So, an organization could have a mission to end hunger. So if it has a mission to end hunger, then that is the legacy that it will create is a world in which there is no hunger, right? And so its reason for existing is to eliminate hunger. So the strategy now tells the organization how you're actually going to achieve that mission, but the mission is your statement of purpose. All right? So mission, where are you going? The organization's purpose for being. It answers, what do we provide society? And then it also helps the organization to establish some boundaries. And those boundaries are important, because without boundaries, you could find yourself veering off into the wider world. I mean, just to put that pictorially for you, if we're saying that this is the overall space within which a company is operating, so society and its needs, then if your organization is within here, that is your organization, then those boundaries tell you that you should not be venturing out into these areas of needs, that you are simply going to focus on the needs that are consistent with your mission. All right? So it does help to provide some boundaries so you know what is it that you should do and what is it that you should not do. Let's take a look at some mission statements. So here's a mission statement of a company called Merck. So the mission of Merck is to provide society with superior products and services, innovations, and solutions that improve the quality of life and satisfy customer needs to provide employees with meaningful work and advancement opportunities and investors with a superior rate of return. So clearly it is a for-profit organization, the fact that there is this emphasis on a superior rate of return. But let's dissect this mission statement a little bit because it will help us understand where operations come in. So the first thing that we talk about is providing superior products and services, or I should say service innovations. Well, what are some of the things that will have implications for that? Superior products would definitely have implications for quality. Would have implications for product design. It would have implications for your, you know, inventory management, because when there is a demand for the product, you certainly want to have availability, right? So superior products could be in terms of quality, could be in terms of variety, in terms of availability, and the kind of design. And here we're talking about innovation. Again, we're talking about service design for sure. It will play a major role. Quality will be a major role as well. So the service quality, the service design, obviously, the effectiveness with which it is able to assist society with achieving whatever their needs are, all right? And of course, you want to look at your supply chain. Also here, the supply chain is important in terms of superior products. Okay, so you begin to see that operations will have a role to play depending on the nature of the services innovations and the nature of the products themselves. Because if you're talking about superior products and you want to be sustainable, then you're going to have to make sure that you can access a sustainable supply chain, right? Or a supply chain in which the suppliers practice environmental sustainability. Now, there is a focus on wanting to improve the quality of life for customers. So that means that there is a need for understanding the nature of the quality of life criteria there. And depending on what that is, maybe to improve the quality of life, we're talking about what kinds of goods. Are those goods and services just basic needs, or are they essentially needs that come from people with disposable incomes who could afford to buy products to entertain themselves, to amuse themselves, and so on? It all depends on what we mean by quality of life here. Which are the markets that they are serving, and what are the needs of that market in terms of quality of life? So they want to satisfy customer needs, and to be able to satisfy customer needs, you have to have the right products, you have to have the right designs, you have to have the right quality levels, the right cost, right, supply chains, you have to have availability and all of these sorts of things, right? At the same time, they want to provide meaningful work. So you may recall that in chapter one, I mentioned that human resource management is actually part of operations. So identifying the right kinds of individuals to work, having good job design, allocating the right workers to the right jobs, having them develop their skills so that they could leverage those skills to enhance their contribution to the organization's mission. All of those things help with regards to meaningful work. So HR becomes a very important dimension, and of course all the training and everything that goes with it. And then when it comes to a superior rate of return, of course you're talking about maximizing profitability here. And then to maximize profitability, you want to do things like, you know, you want to have good sales. Good sales means you have to have a good product, you have to have a good value proposition, and you have to be able to deliver on that value proposition. Sales will be driven by your value proposition. All right? And then you also want to make sure that you optimize your costs associated with producing the products or services. And then of course you have to do some effective financial management, and is the financial management also as well will help you with managing costs, managing investments and so on, and accounting for your financial resources, which will ultimately lead to profitability, and profitability will then lead to a superior rate of return, right? Okay, so I just wanted to just dissect this mission statement and show you that operations has a role to play in doing it. Pepsi-Cola says it should be the world's premier consumer products company, a consumer products company. So it's looking to produce products of a high quality, and it wants to be the premier. That means it needs to be extremely competitive. It needs to be certainly better than its competitors, producing good quality products at an affordable price, or at least at a price that consumers are willing to pay for its products. And of course, it is also focusing on convenient foods and beverages, right? So the word convenience means that it's available everywhere, and that the chances of being able to find the product when you need it is also extremely high. So availability is extremely important in that case. So there are implications for, again, convenient foods, so that would have product design implications, quality implications, inventory implications, right? All of those areas. And then of course they want to produce financial rewards to their investors. So this is a for-profit organization. Arnold Palmer Hospital for Children provides state-of-the-art family-centered healthcare. So the idea of family-centered healthcare means that there's a lot of engagement with families. So how the hospital is structured in terms of its services, how it engages parents, its location, its layout, the kinds of technologies that it uses will have implications for being able to provide state-of-the-art healthcare, right? So state-of-the-art obviously means that this is an environment where you have the latest equipment. So innovation becomes extremely important. Service design is extremely important. How are parents or families integrated in the service process will determine the extent to which this is family-centered. If parents are not integrated in the service design, you cannot call it family-centered, all right? And then, of course, the goal of restoring the joy of childhood in an environment that is full of compassion, healing, and hope. So the healing with the knowledge and technology but also too with the right kind of employees who can demonstrate compassion, right? Who could keep a hopeful disposition that then will empower parents and give them the feeling that their children will be getting better, right? Doctors Without Borders is a not-for-profit. Médecins Sans Frontières, we aim to provide high quality, impartial care. So what when you say high quality care? Impartial, that means no discrimination. And to act always in the best interest of patients while respecting their confidentiality. So high quality would mean that the service has to be provided with the best quality of equipment available. So again, but because we know that Doctors Without Borders go into areas that tend to be rural areas, areas without a lot of resources, so they have to be able to get to those places relatively easily. They have to have a supply chain that could deliver the products that they need to be able to do their jobs. They have to be able to have the kind of logistics that get them in and out of those places if there's a crisis. And so looking at forecasting, project planning, inventory management, supply chain logistics, quality control, all of these areas that have implications for the work that Doctors Without Borders do, okay? Canadian Red Cross, we help people and communities in Canada and around the world in times of need and support them in strengthening their resilience. So when we say we help them in time of need, that means that the Red Cross have to be able to have stockpiles of food and clothing and have areas available for shelter whenever there's a humanitarian crisis. And then of course, assist them in strengthening their resilience, because often their clients are beaten down by whatever disaster that they're experiencing. And so the Red Cross can step in and assist them, all right? Strategy is an action plan to achieve the mission. And there's corporate strategy and there functional strategy. It's important to understand the relationship. So when a company develops its overall strategic plan, that's the corporate strategy. But then that corporate strategy now have to be supported by functional strategies. And those functional strategies can include like your financial strategy, your marketing strategy, and then your operations strategy. Now to develop the operations strategy, we now go in here and there's a whole bunch of areas that we will consider, which would include things like your quality strategy, your process strategy, you could talk about your supply chain strategy, your inventory strategy, so we have a wide number of strategies that basically help to constitute the operation strategy. And the operation strategy is one of the strategies that the organization would require in terms of its functional strategies to support its corporate strategy. So understanding that sort of hierarchical relationship between corporate strategy, functional strategies, and then within a particular functional area, there's sub-strategies. So marketing, for example, could have an advertising strategy, but also just a general communication strategy as well. So I'm sure that there are a number of sub-strategies. In terms of finance, you could have your investment strategy. You could have your cost control strategy. You could have your sales strategy. So there are different types of strategies under each of those core functional areas. So let's talk about now how we sort of align the operation strategy with the corporate strategy. So when we think about it, so essentially you have the corporate strategy, and then you have the, as we're just going to look at the operation strategy for now, not the other two, the ops strategy. So the corporate strategy would have implications for the operations strategy. So what happens now is that to come up with the operations strategy, we have to determine what is it that we're going to do in the various sub-functional areas of operations. Like, what is quality going to look like? What are the kind of individuals we will hire as part of our human resource capacity? What kind of inventory management strategy or systems are we going to use? How are we going to store goods in terms of our warehousing strategy or our suppliers? Who are they going to be? Where are they going to be located? Right? What kind of product and service design? But to answer those questions, the corporate strategy has a set of performance goals. So it has these performance goals, and that is where operations come in terms of helping the organization to achieve those performance goals. So it could be that the organization is really focused on minimizing, right, the cost of providing its services, to its consumers. So it wants to emphasize a sort of a low cost operation. So if it wants to emphasize a low cost operation, it means that you cannot be picking the most expensive or creating the most complex design or the most expensive raw materials or the most expensive suppliers. So the kinds of decisions that you make around your inventory management, the kind of workers that you use, the quality strategy and so on, have to all reinforce low-cost operations, right? You have to reinforce that. And so let us think about three core performance advantages that organizations try to pursue. One is called differentiation, which is to make things different, to make them better, to make them interesting, innovative, sophisticated, all right? And we could call that a sort of a differentiation advantage that the company is looking for, the organization is looking for, or that it wants to focus on cost so that it could actually provide service to consumers as cheaply as possible, or that it could be responsive, have this rapid response to customer needs. Now, responsiveness, when you think about humanitarian crises, responsiveness is going to be a very important performance goal. You're going to have to be able to respond to needs in different places, so that you have to ensure that how you structure the your service, your delivery systems, and so on, have to be able to enable you to reach the various areas that I need. Okay, so differentiation, cost leadership, and response. And each of these areas have implications for the 10 decision areas of one. So differentiation focuses on uniqueness, and it can go both beyond the physical characteristics and the service attributes to encompass everything that impacts the customer's perception of value. So in other words, you're really offering the consumers something that is unique, that is differentiated, not the run-of-the-mill kind of product or service. So Sheepskin Gloves, Walt Disney's Magic Kingdom, Hard Rock Cafe, and then if you think about it in the context of, say, well, it's still a competing organization, but something like Cirque du Soleil, which is in the entertainment industry, certainly they offer differentiation, right? But they are a competing organization. The Red Cross also offers something that is, that it has to tailor to the needs of individual clients. So it has to have some kind of way of differentiating the needs of its respective clients and then being able to provide for them. So it's not a sort of a standardized, kind of commodified service delivery organization. So there is differentiation even in places like, organizations like the Red Cross. Focus on cost, provide the maximum value as perceived by the consumer or the customer, but do that as cheaply as possible. So maximize the, as much as you can, the gap between the perceived value and the cost for the service itself. In Canada, you have Porter Airlines that is supposed to provide cheaper fares to the other two major airlines, such as WestJet or Air Canada. And to be able to do that, it will have to use particular techniques that could lower its costs. So when you look at it, its ground operations, it will consider things like flying into secondary airports, right? Having fewer fare options, not offering a whole lot of service, smaller crews, and so therefore they can offer price discounts. Walmart, small overhead shrinkage, distribution costs. So Walmart tries to offer so-called everyday low prices by really managing the supply chain and driving costs out of the supply chain. So if it's able to do that, it's able to pass on the savings to its customers. Excuse me. And then you have a company called Franz Kollruth. I'm not familiar with them, but they use no bags, low light, no music, and then they have doors on their freezers, so that way it saves the energy consumption. So I guess that's kind of one of the ways that they try to do that. On response now, so response has to do with being flexible, have to do with being fast, also being reliable. And so it's matching your sort of your market changes in design, innovation, and volumes to, you know, so in other words, you have an organization or company that could respond to those very quickly. And so when I talked about Doctors Without Borders, it has to be able to respond to where the needs are. So it's a different kind of response, but nonetheless, it's still a responsive strategy. It has to be able to say, hey, there's an outbreak here. This is the kind of medical care that's needed. That's the kind of equipment that's needed. So it could actually mobilize those resources and move there very quickly. If there's some changes, it has to be able to adapt. So therefore, it has to be flexible. Reliable in meeting schedules, so gym and machinery industry. And timeliness is a quickness in design, production, and delivery. So Pizza Hut, Motorola, Johnson Electric. When you talk about delivery, speed of delivery, these things are quite important. So Amazon, for example, is known for reliability in terms of its delivery promise and the fact that you could get items delivered to you within, if you were willing to pay for it, of course, within two business days, all right? So finally, we want to talk a little bit about global operations. Global operations provide challenges and opportunities. Organizations identify their strengths and weaknesses, missions and strategies are then developed. Competitive advantages can be achieved from global operations. Operations managers have huge impact on decision making. So the point being made here is that more and more we've seen the globalization of operations, that companies don't just simply stay in their sort of geographical locale where they were created. They expand, they become international companies. And those international companies have to be able to have an operation strategy that allows them to be successful in a global sense. All right, so it means that the organization has to have a very deliberate strategy, and operations has to be able to support that particular strategy. So here's an activity for you. I would like you to select a not-for-profit organization such as the YMCA, Hope Blooms in Halifax, which is a social enterprise where young people create a number of products, including salad dressings, from community gardens, and the money is plowed back into the social enterprise to provide supports for the young people themselves. And this is happening in the Halifax community of the North End community of Halifax. The Canadian Red Cross or the Cancer Society or Doctors Without Borders. Examine the mission statement and then ask yourself, what kind of performance focus should that organization have? Should it be one that's based on differentiation, cost, response, flexibility? So give that a ponder and let's hear what you come up with. Okay?